Welcome back to Quick Hits in Laboratory Medicine. Next 10 minutes or so, we're going to talk about biomarkers of myocardial infarction. I was at a cardiology conference maybe 10 years ago, and cardiologists were talking about biomarkers and lab tests, and somebody asked, what's the difference between a lab test and a biomarker? And I piped up and I said, a lab test costs 20 cents and a biomarker costs 20 bucks. And so that's my editorial on biomarkers. Just as a way of background, we're going to talk about ischemic injury and how do these compounds leak out of intracellular sources and into circulation where we can sample them in a blood or plasma specimen. So in ischemic injury, you lose respiration. So you don't have enough energy to maintain cellular gradients of ions. And as a result of that, cellular membranes become permeable and intracellular content starts to leak out into circulation. And when we draw a blood sample, we can find those different compounds. In particular, macromolecules, the bigger molecules, proteins, especially structural proteins, take a bit longer to show up. And so that has an effect on the kinetics of the different markers that you can measure. Used to be really important in cardiac biomarkers. With the highly sensitive troponins, better laboratory tests, that's become sort of less important. So we're going to talk about the troponins. And the good thing about the troponins is that they were the first biomarker that was cardiac specific. So all of our other heart attack markers that we used before troponins cross-reacted with some skeletal muscle damage. And so that was always the trick, was to figure out, is it skeletal muscle or is it myocardial damage? And with the newer, highly sensitive troponins that are very specific, we have good tests for looking at necrosis of myocytes. And that's my take-home message. Troponins are necrosis markers. The natriuretic peptides are stretch markers, they're volume overload markers. Today we're talking about, in the next 10 minutes, we're talking about biomarkers for necrosis, and that's the troponins. So it's saying that myocytes are dying, and anytime myocytes are dying, that's not good. Why are the troponins so good? They're good because the amino acid composition of troponins in skeletal muscle is different than that of cardiac muscle. So we now have proteins that have amino acids that are specific for the myocardium, we can develop antibodies against them and have cardiac-specific tests. In fact, it actually changed the definition of MI. The definition of an MI starts out with a change in a biomarker, and troponins being the preferred biomarker. So that rise and or fall of troponins along with clinical symptoms defines an MI. And again, in an acute event, that's really one of the critical criteria is it changing? And so change in time is really important for the diagnosis of myocardial infarction. There are a lot of things that cause increases of troponin, but typically end-stage renal failure, for example, causes significant elevations of troponin, but they're a consistent elevation. They're bumping along, you know, maybe 10 times what the reference range is, but they're not changing acutely. It's when they're changing acutely that we diagnose MIs. So as I said, they're elevated in a lot of other conditions besides MI, and to help differentiate, we're looking for acute changes. And as I alluded to, the assays have become more sensitive. We are now what we call the fifth generation or highly sensitive troponins, and we'll talk a little bit about that in a second. So this is a cartoon of what the troponins look like. So this is troponin I. It is part of the troponin tropomyosin complex. This is a myofibril, so this is the contractile apparatus of a muscle cell. Troponin T is here. Troponin C binds calcium. Troponin C is not a cardiac biomarker because it shares amino acid homology sequences as with skeletal muscle. So both troponin I and troponin T are cardiac biomarkers because the amino acid sequence of troponin I in skeletal muscle is different than it is in myocardium. Same thing with troponin T. So we've got good cardiac biomarkers based on troponin T as well as troponin I. Some people will argue that T is better than I. Some people will argue I is better than T. Objectively, they're both good necrosis markers of myocytes. This is a slide taken from the fourth definition of myocardial infarction, published a couple years ago. And on the y-axis, this is concentration of cardiac troponin. This could be troponin T or troponin I, so high concentrations versus low concentrations. We talked about the definition of a myocardial infarction in a different session, and really it comes down to that 99th percentile. And so most reference ranges are inner 95th percentile. In the setting of troponin, it's above the 99th percentile that we get concerned. And so if you're less than the 99th percentile, we're really not concerned. If you're very early in sampling, patients can come in with chest pain and be below the 99th percentile. Historically, the rule out was, you know, draw another troponin 6 or 8 hours later. In the setting of highly sensitive troponins, we're now changing that to be 1 or 3 hours later so we can triage patients much faster in the ED. And so that's one of the things that the highly sensitive troponins are providing, is the ability to do rapid rule-outs. So again, we're looking for changes in time. So you would measure one sample. If they're in the normal range and you have a high suspicion that they, you know, they've got acute chest pain, then you're going to want to keep that patient and draw another sample in 1 or 3 hours later and look for that increase. If you're very late, so you know, we clearly want patients to be coming in early. There are life-saving therapies that are given and procedures that can be done. If they come in early enough, the adage time is tissue is very apt here. So we want patients to come in early, and we want to be sampling their biomarkers early and looking for that change, that rise and fall, you know, in the 1 to 3 hour time frame. There's also, if the suspicion is low and you have a negative troponin, there's good negative predictive values in that early time frame as well. In the diagnosis, we're looking for that change in time, so a second sampling to show that it's changing. This is an example of what happens in, say, chronic renal failure. So this blue dotted line, significant elevation of troponin, but it's not changing in a rapid time frame. So in that case, we would expect it. And typically, what people talk about as a significant change is a 20% change, or at the low end, maybe 5 or 7 nanograms per liter. So those are sort of the two different changes that we're looking for. So highly sensitive troponins, they are defined as the ability to measure troponin in 50% of the population. The earlier generations of troponins, we couldn't measure a normal troponin in anyone. We could only measure it when it was elevated. And that was fairly simple, because if it was elevated, that was bad. But we were missing things earlier on. And so being able to measure 50% of the population with good precision at the cut points of the 95th percent or the 99th percentile is really what defines a highly sensitive troponin. And they allow us to do the rapid rule outs. And that's significant. If you have chest pain, you're worried about having a heart attack, if you have to wait in the ED for 6 or 8 hours just to get the labs drawn, then that's not good. With the highly sensitive, we've now changed that to be a 0/1/3 kind of rule out. And that has had a positive impact on getting patients earlier discharged if they're not having an MI. Another lab that we should be aware of, it was the cornerstone of diagnosis for a long time. The troponins have largely replaced it, but they still get used, and that's creatinine and creatine kinase. So creatine is present in all muscle cells, and muscle cells secrete creatine. About 1 to 2% per day of creatine is converted into creatinine, and creatinine is what we use to monitor renal function, because there's a relatively stable source of it. And the assumption is that it's not secreted or reabsorbed, and it's freely filtered. And we'll talk about whether or not those are good assumptions or not, but that's how we use creatinine. Creatine is also phosphorylated by an enzyme called creatine kinase to form phosphocreatine. And phosphocreatine is the energy source for muscle contraction. Creatine kinase is an enzyme that puts a phosphate group on there, and we monitor creatine kinase for muscle damage. It can be either smooth muscle damage or it could be myocytes. And creatine kinase is a dimer. There's two different sections of creatine kinase, an M form and a B form. So you can have CKMM, which is the muscle form, CKMB, which predominates in the myocardium, or CKBB, which is a higher prevalence found in actually brain tissue. And so if we're concerned about myocardial damage, we actually monitor the MB iso, the isoform. So this is an old chart, but I think it's very useful because it shows the different CK isoenzymes. So we mentioned there's an MM, that's the muscle form, and 99% of skeletal muscle is CKMM. However, 1% of skeletal muscle is CKMB. And so CKMB, even though we think about it as being the heart type, it is also present in skeletal muscle. And that's been that was a problem with creatine kinase for forever, actually. Looking at the myocardium, you have 77% CKMB, but 22% CKMM. I'm sorry, 77% CKMM and 22% CKMB. So this gives rise to what we call the relative index. And if you measure total CK, and then you figure out that more of the total CK is comprised of the CKMB form, then you likely have heart damage versus skeletal muscle damage. And so that gives rise to this equation we call the CK index. And CK indexes still get used when there's a confusing picture with a patient and potentially for myocardial reinfarctions. So CKMB mass, so this is looking at nanograms per mil of the heart subtype versus the total activity. And if you have cardiac damage, then your CK index is going to be high. If you have skeletal muscle damage, which has less CKMB, then you're going to have a low CK index. And so if the CKMB is greater than the reference range and the index is greater than 2.5, so the relative index being greater than 2.5, then that suggests cardiac damage. Whereas if it's less than the, if it's greater than the reference range and the index is low, you have skeletal muscle damage. So that ends the quick hits in cardiac biomarkers. Thanks for tuning in.